Hi everyone, this is Madhusudan Raj, 20th August 2012, and I'm back with my weekly economic report. This week I again want to start with some banking sector news because last week there were reports that more and more banks are getting serious problems of asset quality. Asset quality of banks a serious cause for concern. And as I said in my last week report, all these banks are actually inherently bankrupt all the time. They cannot respect the demands of their depositors if they all go at the same time and ask for their money back. They have lent out that money to other people, and that's the reason why. Because they work on the basis of fractional reserve standards, so they don't have the money available with them, only some fraction of that depositors' money is with them in their reserves, and the whole banking sector is actually working on the public's confidence. People are confident that banks will respect the demands, and that's why they are not going together to ask their money back. But the day this confidence will be broken and the bank, you know, people will be suspicious of this bank's capacity of respecting the demands, their solvency, the day they will start questioning bank solvency, this inherent bankrupt nature of all the commercial banks will be revealed on that day. And that is going to happen in future. But not only that the asset quality is deteriorating and bad debt is piling up on these banks' books. On the other side, what is happening is this new finance minister, P. Chidambaram, is very much going to exaggerate this problem for commercial banks with his economic policy. Last week, he ordered all these commercial banks to loosen the terms and condition and offer affordable EMI schemes, equated monthly installment scheme. And he also told banks to cut their interest rate on the loans of consumer durable goods. So the logic or the illogic which a finance minister is using, that he's thinking with most of the mainstream Keynesian economies, that if banks are going to cut the interest rate, lower the interest rate and loosen the terms and condition of this monthly installment lending schemes, and that is going to result into a higher demand for consumer durable goods, and that is going to revive the manufacturing sector, which is right now in trouble. That is going to create, you know, economic growth. That is going to bring the slowing economic Indian economy out of problems. But if you understand how the economy actually functions, then it is very easy to know that this kind of economic logic is absurdity. The whole logic is absolutely flawed, because what these people are basing their policies on is Keynesian notion that consumption is the driver of economy. And you understand that consumption is not the driver of economy. Actually, economy is not a car and there is no single driver of economy. But just for the sake of argument, if we continue with this, you know, this terminology that economy is a car and there are some drivers, or there is some driver, then that driver is production and not consumption. Because to consume something, you have to produce something in the first place. Without production, consumption is simply not possible. And both these processes are counterproductive. So if you consume more, you cannot produce more. And if you produce more, you have to cut back on your consumption. To understand this, you have to understand John Stuart Mill's fourth proposition in his very famous book, Principles of Political Economy. In that book, in his fourth proposition, John Stuart Mill said that demand for commodities is not demand for labor. So there is this flawed notion of derived demand for labor. People think that if we consume, then that is going to create demand for laborers, and that is going to create employment, and that is going to generate more output, and that is going to revive the economic growth. But this whole notion is flawed to begin with, because more consumption means less production. You have to understand from where the production is coming. Because to produce something, you have to hire the laborers, and when you hire labor, you have to pay them wages, and these wages are not going to come from consumption, or they're not going to come from money printing. These wages are going to come from prior savings. So this is how the whole process works. You produce something first and then you abstain from consuming most part of it. That means you save, and this saving is going into investment. And when you invest into different production processes, you use this capital fund, this wage fund, to give wages to laborers, to pay the capitalists, you know, and other factors of production. And that is going to create, you know, you're going to accumulate more and more capital goods, and this accumulation of capital goods is going to raise your future income, raise the production. That is what is going to result into growing economy. But as I said, if you consume more, then that means you're necessarily saving less, and if you're saving less, you have less funds to hire laborers, and if you are not produce more capital goods, accumulation of capital goods is going to get into trouble. And if that is going to happen, then that's going to result into less future production, reduced future income, lower economic growth in future. So this policies of boosting consumption is absolutely counterproductive, and it is not going to result into higher economic growth in future. Actually, it is going to reduce the whole capital base of the economy. It is going to eat into the capital stock of economy, and that is going to reduce the future economic growth of the Indian economy. So this lunatic policies of boosting consumption via lowering the interest rate is going to create more problem. And you have to understand that by lowering the interest rate, you know, by creating money out of thin air and lowering the interest rate, they're not going to create savings. Saving comes from production. You have to produce something first. In fact, the money is also needed to be produced in the first place. Now, I'm not going into this whole process right now. I don't have time for that. Maybe in some future video blogs, I'll explain this whole process. But right now, you have to understand that you cannot print saving. You have to produce something, abstain from consumption, and that's what is saving, and that is going to give you the investment fund, and that's going to result into capital accumulation and higher economic growth. So this policies of finance minister is going to create disaster for the Indian economy. Not only that, last week also inflation data came out. The July inflation unexpectedly dropped, but at the same time what happened is the core inflation went up. So how is this possible? How one inflation number can come down and how the other inflation number can go up. That is only possible when these economists and politicians, policymakers are manipulating this data. You have to understand that to measure inflation, these economists use different price indexes. First of all, the definition is wrong. They think that rise in the general price level is inflation, which it is not. As I said, creation of money and credit out of thin air is inflation. Rise in the prices, general price labor rises, and rise in the different, you know, prices is just one effect of inflation. But in any case, even if we say that price rise is inflation, let's say just to argue this point, if we accept their definition, then even then price doesn't measure value of money. Because they think that price measures value of money. It doesn't. Price is just an exchange ratio between two products which are exchanging in a transaction process. In every transaction process, there are two sides involved. And on one side, you have demand and supply of an economic good. And then on the other side, you have demand and supply of money, which is exchanging against this economic good. So these economic goods prices are actually expressed in terms of this common medium of exchange money, and because that is a common denominator, so the price of all the economic goods available in an economy is expressed in terms of rupee or, you know, whatever your currency denomination is. It's not going to measure anything. It's not going to measure the value of money or whatever, or even economic good. It's not going to measure that. The price are actually just expressed or appraised in terms of money. It is not measuring inflation. And not only that, you know, this is the inherent methodological flaw. The economic logic is flawed, but also the methodology with these economists used to create their price indexes are highly fishy, and actually they manipulate the data a lot. For example, in India, economists use wholesale price index. So what they do, they go into the wholesale market and collect prices of different goods and services which they have arbitrarily chosen. They think that these are the products which we all are consuming, so without asking us and without taking our opinion or without understanding our subjective values, they decide arbitrarily that these are the products which consumers are right now consuming, and they go and collect their data, their price data from the wholesale market. And you understand that in the wholesale market, the prices are most likely, almost all the time, going to be lower than in the consumer retail market. So these lower prices are going to reflect into the lower inflation numbers, and that's what economists, this government economists and policymakers, they want. They want to show that inflation number is lower than what actually it is, so that they can get their votes and everything. So they are fooling people. And again, they are using this other concept called core inflation, and to measure or calculate core inflation, they take out food items and energy items out of the consideration. Can you imagine anyone living the life without food items and energy items? That's the major consumption products, and these economists take these two items out of their calculation, and then they said this is core inflation. It is not actually inflation at all, because if they include that, then the inflation number will be higher. So it's all manipulation. It is all to fool you guys. Right. Very interesting thing happened in my own state, Gujarat. Also, the very popular Chief Minister Narendra Modi, he announced that he is going to ban the consumption of gutkha, the pan masala, which is very famous amongst people. From 11th September 2012. As I said, all these politicians are ignorant of basic economic laws, of all economic laws, the human action laws, the praxeological laws. Their interest is mainly in controlling people. They are politicians, and politicians, political power means controlling other people's lives. So he arbitrarily decided that he's going to ban gutkha consumption. He's saying that he doesn't want the young people of Gujarat to basically deteriorate their health and do something wrong with their health. Well, I can understand that, but it's as I said, it's just a smoke and mirror. It's just a face of this whole policy. The behind this policy logic is completely different, and as I said, even if that's the aim, then these are not the right means of achieving those ends. Banning something is not going to result into a reduction of its consumption. In fact, it is very likely that consumption of gutkha product will increase, because now it's a price commodity. Youngsters will think that why government is banning gutkha. So instead of reducing its consumption, more and more young people, all segments of the society will be attracted to gutkha. Not only that, this ban is only going to create more and more problem. What will happen? The first thing that will happen is the price of these gutkha products will go up, and it has already started to happen in Saurashtra region, where gutkha consumption is very high. Many sellers are now hoarding gutkha, stocking up, because they know that once this ban kicks in on 11 September, this will be very difficult to sell. So they're stocking up, and what they will do is the whole production and selling will go into underground. And because it's going to be a very tough business, and it's going to be an illegal business, very risky business, so this business is also going to attract anti-social elements, mafias and bootleggers and other guys who are right now very much active in the alcohol business, which is also banned in Gujarat. So when these people will enter this business, it's going to create a lot of social problems. Crime will increase. So this simple health problem is going to result into economic and social problem. Narendra Modi is going to create more and more social problems. And actually, that's what governments want. More problem, more bureaucracies, more employment for the parasitic class of the society, and taxpayers are going to be in trouble. People are going to lose everything. The only entity which is going to benefit from this ban is the government, whose revenues will go up, and the policemen, because policemen now have one more excuse to loot innocent people. They are going to extract more bribe and more corruption money from these gutkha sellers, and they will allow under their eye all this selling. But as I said, the price will only go up. So their revenue is going to increase, their employment, so-called employment, is going to increase, and we are all going to be into trouble. Not only that, there was also this 3.8 lakh crore coal mining corruption scandal, and Manmohan Singh's government, and maybe allegedly he also is involved into this scandal, and they gave a cheap land, coal mining rights, and everything to this businessman, Reliance company, and other business people. And as I'm saying since long, that these are not market reforms. India is a fascist country. The whole world is fascist right now. These so-called businessmen, they are actually criminals. Criminals because they are not serving their consumers and earning their profit by serving their consumers in the best way, producing good quality products at the cheapest possible price. Instead of that, they are making this illegitimate profit by working in cahoots with the government. They are looting the public, looting the common man by shaking hands with the politicians, all these Tatas and Birlas and Ambanis and Bajaj and all these so-called businessmen, these tycoons, I call them corporatist elites. They are looting all of us. They are many farmers are losing their land every day. Many common men, many poor people are losing their livelihood every day because of this. Not only that, this environment is also getting damaged. Natural resources are getting depleted very quickly because these politicians are very short-sighted. They just want to make quick buck and get out of their position. So this is creating all kinds of problem. Last but not the least, finance minister hinted at more market reforms, and there is no market actually. All these so-called market reforms are fascism. So he asked the stock market regulator SEBI to create some kind of attractive mutual fund scheme so that they can divert people's attention from gold. And they are saying that they want to encourage people to invest in mutual funds. So as I said, government is after gold right now because they understand that gold exposes their Senani guns and their financial profligacy. So that's why they are after gold. But as I said, when government is saying something, you have to do exactly opposite to that. So if they say don't buy gold, you have to buy gold. So don't get fooled by finance minister and stock market and other finance so-called financial expert advice that you have to go and invest in mutual fund, stock market. All these sectors, these paper promise sectors, are very risky right now, very volatile, very much manipulated. There is no free market out there. So a common man will definitely get burned. His fingers will be burned if he's going to get involved into all this so-called, investment option. These are the paper promises, and when the real financial crisis will arrive in future, all this financial sector will go bust. The only last thing which is going to be standing is this precious metal, gold and silver, and other, hard asset like agricultural land, farmland, commodities, and other items. So don't get fooled by the government. Keep on accumulating gold and silver regularly. As I said, use the money average cost method and keep your purchasing power and wealth stable. All right, so thank you very much for watching this week, and I'll be back with more news in next week. Bye-bye.